And we have one more presentation left, and that's going to be a very interesting one. So I believe you would have visited the exhibit hall, and we have a humanoid robot out there. So the next speaker is all about the humanoid robot. So let me call upon Mr. Pratheesh, Prakash, who is the director and head of R&D at Robo Inventions. So, Pratheesh, may I please have you on stage?
Good afternoon. I'm Pratheesh. Hope everybody has a little bit of energy left after the long day. We've had a very long month, to say. So I'm Pratheesh from Robo Inventions. Robo Inventions is a company that manufactures robots, and we are based out of Kerala. And we are heavily supported by the Kerala Startup Mission in our endeavors. And we manufacture different kinds of robots, customized robots and all that. Right now, we had the first product release or a mass-produced robot that we have brought out today, and I'll be talking about that. And I'll be talking about how we tried to build a robot from scratch in India without having much of a problem. We've had industrial interactions. We've had people with a lot of skill telling us what to do. So I'll share my story on how we developed that scalable robot here. So our core ideology has been from a very long time to make stuff indigenously. So as you may know, electronics, robotics, everything has a Chinese make. So most of the companies try to manufacture or get Chinese OEM and rebrand it here. So we've tried not to do that. We've tried to manufacture our own product here with our own styling. Okay, so we've been associated with Autodesk for a long time, and we are right now Autodesk Fusion 360 user evangelists. And Autodesk has supported us in many ways. When I was a student, I used to use Autodesk Inventor student license. Now, being a startup, we've also got access to Autodesk Fusion 360, the startup license, which has been really useful for us in all the fields, including CAD, CAM, and simulation. So, let's just talk about how Fusion has helped us in place of other softwares. If we had other softwares playing, what would other softwares do, and what would Fusion do in the same place? So, CAD and I suppose everybody knows CAD and CAM functionality are separate functionalities. So the software, each software or each segment has a different software. CAD has a separate set of softwares, CAM has a separate set of softwares. So once you design your file in CAD, you have to export it to a particular format, step format, let's say, and then send it to the CAD designing guy. They open it in their software, then they see an error, then they get back to you with that error. So it's a pretty long process. So conveying the error from the CAM and CAM to the CAD is a bit of a cumbersome process. So why, how Fusion 360 does that is by integrating the CAM and the CAD environments into one, you can do an iterative process. You can actually go back and forth between the CAM and the CAD environments and get to a correct point without even going to a stage of machining the part. You can just go to the CAM environment, simulate it, and see wherever the interferences are, come back to your CAD environment, optimize the process, and go back to your CAM environment. Okay. So that allows for a very fast, what to say, transition between an idea to a product. So I'll be showing you a few parts for the current robot that we did in the simulation environment and the CAM environment. So another great aspect of Fusion 360 is collaborative design. So collaborative design allows my team, I have a very small team, but we have to interact between a lot of different softwares. We have the electronics design handled by a few people. We have the CAD design handled by a few people. We have a CAM design system being handled by a separate set of people. So all these teams have to be integrated, and all these teams have to work in synchrony. So collaborative design allows us to do that. How we do that is we have a version control software as well as collaborative softwares built into Fusion 360, where, for example, if I'm traveling, during my travel itself, I can suggest some changes in a CAM or a CAD file by just going through the file on the Autodesk Fusion 360 app, which is very useful. So if I have a doubt coming from my design team that if this should be changed and I'm traveling, I can just pop out my phone, use the Fusion 360 app, look at the file. I don't even have to download anything. I just can just go and click the file name, and the file name will open up in a viewer. I can circle the same error and send it back to the team, and within half an hour, I would have the second iteration of the file. That has been really helpful because I being a very small team, we have to multitask. So collaborative design is one part that has been very, very, very useful. Okay. Now, another part of Fusion 360 is the cloud-based, it's a cloud-based software. So the rendering and the heavy end part of the program is actually run on a cloud. So it becomes very light for a system. You need not have a very high-end system to run Fusion 360. You can run it on a very low-end system and have the functionality of a very high-end CAD and CAM processor. Okay. Now, moving on. Now, let's get to a part where we started designing robots in Fusion 360. So we have a few things that we did in Fusion 360. The robot's body had to be first made, designed basically. Then we had to engineer the internals. Then we had to design the electronics. Electronics was actually designed in another software called Autodesk Eagle, which allows us to collaborate between Autodesk Fusion 360 and Eagle. So Eagle can actually export files that are compatible with Autodesk Fusion 360. So now what we did was, again, simulation and CAM. So simulation and CAM are the last part. Idea to prototype. So when we had an idea, we would just jot down it on a jot it out on a paper and then go design it in the design environment. So the design environment, right now for the design of the robot, we had used the we have used a very fluidic design. So for that, we've used surface modeling. So the surface modeling environment allows us to sculpt any kind of fluidic shapes into, it can be a car, it can be a bike, it can be anything. So for example, our robot is very fluidic in nature. So we went through the surface modeling environment and designed the robot first. After designing the robot, we actually modeled the internals. Internals being all the motors and all the electronic parts that had to go in, we had modeled them roughly out in Fusion 360 again, and then use this to test the interference parameters. So now, with this, we actually reached a point where we saw that the design had a slight flaw. So if Fusion 360's iterative design and, let's say, the assembly points were not there, we wouldn't have been able to find it out initially itself. So what we found out was the parts that we had designed the robot for were 10 to 20% larger than what we had expected to. So after modeling and seeing the interference, we just went back to the design environment or the sculpt environment, rescaled the parts to just the parts that we needed to fit, and then came back to the engineering or the CAD part. Now, coming to the CAD part, the file that you see here is one of the wheels that we use. So our specific USP, our robot, most of you have you seen the robot today? Have you gone to the Siddhartha hall and seen the robot? So if you've seen the robot, you'll understand that the robot doesn't actually have a front or a back. There is a simulated front. The robot need not face any direction to move that direction. The robot can actually slide around. So the robot is not restricted by its front or back to move. It can actually slide around. It can actually do this action like a human does to avoid obstacles. So why we've used these kind of wheels is to make it more navigable in tight spaces. So the robot, again, is designed for the service industry. So where the service industry, hospitals and hotels, is what we've designed the robot for. So you will have a lot of people interacting with the robot. So we wanted the robot to be very easily navigatable between these people. So this is the specific design, engineering design that we did there. So this wheel is one of the wheels that is used in your robot. There are four different wheels. Each wheel has roughly 40 to 50 parts, separate parts. This, if we had used any other environment, would have been impossible to do in less than 3 months. We achieved something like this in roughly 1.5 months with just one iteration. We have not made a single prototype of this, but we got it out in one go and it came out perfect. So it also has reduced our cost and times by a huge sum by simulating it before going to manufacturing. So we designed this file, we simulated it in the environment to see if it would work as we intended it to. And then we found out some flaws. We went back to the drawing board, reiterated the design, and sent it for camming. Okay. So once the cam part came, it went like a breeze. Everything fit together perfectly. And there was something very interesting that we used here. So there is a list of items already that you have. Let's say you have nuts and bolts, you have different screws, you have different nuts and bolts and everything manufactured by a company called McMaster Car or being sold by a company called McMaster Car as a listing inside Fusion 360. So you don't have to design the threaded rods or threaded screws that you want, you're going to use. You can just type the part number, you can get that file, you can get the CAD file, embed it into your software. Once you have the part ready, once you have the design ready, you can export the BOM. You can export the bill of materials and send it to the purchasing team, and they can just get you all the parts that you require. So it's so easy. So all the different parts of the robot, there are a huge number of parts. So keeping an itinerary of all the parts would have been a huge task for us. So this, again, simplified our task a lot more for us. Then, CAM. Again, if you had looked at the robot, you would understand that the robot is made out of composite materials. So our challenge here was to get it done in India. We could have gone outside, we could have manufactured it outside, but we wanted to do it here in India, and specifically in Kerala. So we knew that there were companies that were doing from CAD to final part, but we never found out how they were doing it. So we approached a lot of composite manufacturers to convert our CAD design to an actual model, which was not possible. After 1.5 months of searching, we ended up with zero results. So then we ended up doing the CAM part and the machining on our own. We actually took tooling foam. I'll show you the robot's image. I think you'll get an idea from there. So this is the robot. So you'll see a lot of curves on the robot. It's very curved and very fluidic. You cannot expect a person to take a look at the picture and have the part ready with his hand. It's very difficult to recreate something so complex with just an image. So we wanted the part to be to the mm accurate. So what we did was, we looked at the internet, found out some ways, took help from the manufacturing teams, and found out a way where we could actually tool foam or use tooling foam to cut it in a CNC machine and use it as a pattern for molding process. So what we did was we took the tooling foam, we used a CNC machine called as a shopbot. Like I said initially, we are supported heavily by Kerala Startup Mission. Kerala Startup Mission has a fab lab facility in Cochin, which has a lot of fabrication machines, CNC machines, 3D printers, laser cutters and all those machines. We've been using them heavily. So we've used their shopbot machine to cut out the tooling foam and get the roughed out 3D part of the robot. Once we had the part in foam, we actually made the mold out of the robot and then got out an actual robot from the mold. So this was a very long process for us, but the interactions actually reduce the times by a huge sum. Okay, so coming back, so we used it for camming. Then the question rises, why do you want to make robots in India when you can just buy it from China or any other country? So India is a manufacturing economy. India has a lot of machining centers and automobile industries that are dependent on machining. So North India has a huge amount of machining centers that manufacture taps, that manufacture handles, designer handles for export quality. So I, what our thought process was, why not utilize or leverage the skills available at these places and utilize their machine times to manufacture robots in India, which will be much more cost effective to do. So that's why we settled in making the robot here. And after going through a lot of searching, we found out that we were actually sitting inside one of India's largest manufacturing areas. We were sitting in Cochin, and we were just 11 kilometers away from a manufacturing hub. So we have a huge number of machining shops, huge number of CNC machine job shops, where we could approach and talk to them. So we started approaching a huge number of people. We started approaching and telling them that it is a very low volume job. Most of them didn't reply. Some started helping us out. Some started directing us to different people. And finally, we got through to two people who agreed to do a low volume manufacturing for the initial product. So after going through that, and then sitting down with them to ideate how to machine the different parts, again, this part was what we manufactured the first. So we wanted to test out the wheels, the mechanics of the wheels before we started designing the robot. So we manufactured this first, and we tested out the wheels. Once the wheels were ready, we moved on to the body. Like I said, we machined the tooling foam, and we used it to make a fiberglass mold. Then we have a good amount of raw material available in India. We have very good grade aluminium that is available in India at very moderate cost. So instead of going to China and buying a ready-to-use robot, we decided to make our own robot because of these few reasons. Now, then, so let me talk a little bit more about how or what the robot is. So we call the robot Hero, and Hero is short for humanoid intended for robotic operation. Okay. So what it does is, my company's name is actually Robo Inventions. The product's name is Hero. So this is meant for the service industry. Like I said, so we are aiming at industries like the medical industry, the hospitality industry, and malls or premium offices. So what we want the robot to do is the recursive menial tasks like carrying stuff from point A to point B that have been very difficult for people by creating a lot of, fatigue in their daily lives. To reduce that, we've designed this. So let's take this as an example. Let's say today, if you go to a hospital, each hospital uses its nurses to move around its stuff. We have very little hospitals that have extra compounders just to move stuff. For moving stuff, heavy duty stuff, let's say laundry, medical equipment, medical waste, you use your nurses. Nurses are a skilled set of people. For them pushing around a cart with just a huge amount of load is not meaningful. So we can actually replace those tasks which require a huge amount of payload to be carried from point A to point B by using this robot. So what this is going to do is, at present, the market has a few service industry robots, but these robots are not capable to carry anything more than 4 or 5 kgs of payload. Our robot is capable of carrying 120 kgs of payload on its arm. So the arms are modular. These arms are actually replaceable. According to the industry that we are catering to, these arms will contain different kinds of attachments. Let's say, for example, here you can see the tray attachment that it's carrying the medical equipment with. You can have a basket attachment if you want to carry the laundry. And there are multiple attachments. So this is the medical industry. Then Moving on, you can have premium hotels serve food to customers through robots. And one specialty of the robot is the robot doesn't have any touchscreen to touch. The robot can understand a person talking. So it's called natural language processing. It has machine learning and natural language processing to understand what he's saying and to understand the context of what the person is saying. So if so, for example, if he wants to order a wine, he can go and say that I want a so-and-so wine, and the robot will understand that and convey that to the main system. So after converting it into data, it can actually send it to the software that the hotel uses. Then you can utilize it in malls and offices just as an information kiosk or to guide people around inside the malls so that they can reach a particular spot. Let's say I want to go to a particular shop. I can ask the robot where that shop is, and the robot can take you that to that shop. So the robot has one more specialty inbuilt. The robot has the lift integration built into it. Lift integration is the robot can control the lift inside your building. Second thing is the robot doesn't require any other infrastructure rather than itself being implemented there. You don't have to put markers on your ground. You don't have to put any specific markers for the robot to navigate around. The robot uses visual odometry to calculate the distances and reach the spot that it wants to reach. It will know wherever you switch it on, it knows wherever it's standing, and you can tell it to go to point A to point B, and it'll understand that and reach that position. So that's about the robot, and that's how we built a robot from scratch in India. And we've had a lot of people helping us out, huge set of people helping us out from different walks of life. We've had machinists telling us how to optimize our process. We've had industrial experts telling us how to design stuff more efficiently. We've had people designing stuff for us. Let's say we've had Gurpreet. Gurpreet is sitting here. He's been, can you just raise your hand, please? Gurpreet has been a designer who's been working with us. So we've had a lot of people telling us a lot of stuff. So this is not just our hard work. This is a 100, 150 people's hard work in the last 3 years. So we've been able to do that with their help. So I cannot go off without giving them credits. So that's about it. If there are any questions, I can take them.
I have one question.
Yeah, please.
Can it draw in AutoCAD?
Huh?
Can it draw in AutoCAD?
No. At present, no. Not yet. Once that is done, then we wouldn't be required.
What will be the cost of this?
So the cost at present, we've not finalized the cost. We are a business to business product. So if somebody requires, they are approaching us directly, and we cannot give it a particular cost because this is not just the product that we're giving. It's a full environment that we're giving, full ecosystem that we're giving. Let's say, for example, a hotel calls us and tells us that we want to implement it in our hotel. We have to integrate the software also for them. There's a software backend for this robot. Let's say the room service industry requests it. So we will actually give them a software app that can actually call the robot to the particular room with whatever amenities it requires. So with the current design, I'll tell you something. Switched off, I think. Okay, so with the current design, there's the torso of the robot is fully empty. We can actually integrate dispensing machines into the robot. So we've kept the torso mainly empty for any add-on applications that we can do. So only the head and the chassis part of the robot is filled with electronics and all the equipment. The remaining part is empty. So for example, room service, you can have towels, 10 or 15 towels, maybe toothbrushes, and a few stuff stocked into the torso, and it can dispense those to the particular rooms that they are calling to.
Why this question came now is regarding cost. See, we are also trying to move our industry towards
automation.
4.0,
yeah.
What all those people we are speaking about.
Yeah.
But the biggest challenge what we are facing is the cost.
Yeah.
So exactly. The customer, you know, will not pay.
Customer,
you know,
wants premium, yeah, quality with,
exactly,
low cost.
Yes. So that is why this cost came into picture. And one more question I have. So right now, which language it can understand? Only English?
Only English. At present, only English. Because, okay, like I said, the NLP or the natural language processing algorithm is running on the cloud. And the cloud is an English cloud. So at present, only English. Please.
Hi, good evening.
Yeah.
Are you just into humanoids or will you be venturing into industrial robots?
No, we have an industrial robot in the pipeline. This is just the first product. January end, we are actually releasing the industrial robot. We are actually releasing a robot that can that is meant for inventory management. So it is. It doesn't look like look more like a robot. It looks more like a square box moving around. So it's coming out. It's coming out in January end. So we have six robots actually planned, one after the other. After January, we have three more robots. Then again, one or two more.
Yeah, you were saying that the wheels that you made, that was just one shot for the manufacturing.
Yes, exactly.
So how confident were you that it will be 100% perfect?
We were not confident. We had to try it out. We went through the... so we ourselves were surprised. That's why I said that specifically here. So the first time we designed it, we didn't believe that we could do it in one go because it was so complex. All these parts had to fix in so together and had to have very very really tight tolerances. So the tolerances between these parts is roughly 0.5 mm. So if it is offset by even 0.1 mm more, the parts will lock out. So these wheels will not roll. So we were not confident that we could do it in one go. But we did it. After doing the iteration on the simulation environment, we came out with the part first time. So we sent it for a single part. We required multiple parts. We sent in one part, thinking that we couldn't confidently get a proper part in one go. We got one part and we then ordered the whole lot together.
Okay. So for the simulation, the mechanical and electrical, you both simulated in Fusion 360 only.
No, the electrical part we didn't simulate. We had only checked the interference parameters of the mechanical design of the electrical board. So, for example, there are three boards on board this robot. So there were tight spaces where we had to fit the boards. There is one board here. There is one board behind that board, and there is one board here. So here you have a lot of space, but again you have a lot of stuff going around in that. So that these three boards had to be fit into a very tight space, and these three boards are pretty huge, electronics-wise they are pretty big. So we had to get the design, resize the boards according to this, and then design again in the electrical CAD file. Is it clear?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Pratheesh.
Yeah.
Good to see the startup ecosystem in Cochin and appreciate your efforts. A couple of questions actually. One, you said McMaster-Kerr.
Yeah, McMaster-Kerr.
I thought it was not available in India for us to access.
No, the parts are not available. You can get a BOM from them. You cannot buy from McMaster-Kerr. But the thing is, all the parts that McMaster-Kerr manufactures, 90% of them are available in India. You can just take the same technical specs and go to the market or go to the specific vendor and they'll give you the same parts.
Actually, it simplifies lots of efforts creating gears and spur gears and all.
Exactly.
But we tried it and said access from India is banned when we tried
to
access the catalog.
No, McMaster-Kerr will not provide you here. Yeah. So this is a workaround that we've worked. You cannot buy from McMaster-Kerr.
You cannot buy, I understand, but we can't even download the design from McMaster-Kerr.
No, we've downloaded the design very easily. We've been doing that for the last 6 to 8 months. We've been doing it. We have so many fitment parts that we require that are actually not our parts. So we download screws. We download threaded rods. We have shafts, very tight tolerance shafts that we required. So all those were downloadable very easily.
Okay.
I think maybe there is some issue. I think you can clarify with the Autodesk team. But we've been able to do it very smoothly.
Okay. Other thing is about the social aspects of the robot, you know.
Mm-hmm.
When we recently had a big strike in Kerala for the nurses' basic salary,
yes,
you know.
Yes.
Don't you think you will face some traction from society when you try to take jobs away from...
Yes, I understand where this question is going. So I've been asked this question multiple times. Again, time and again, the answer that I give is, we are not trying to replace human labor. We are actually trying to... What to say? Substitute human labor. Substitute as in we don't want to replace the nurses. We want to help them out. We want to remove the fatigue factor from their work. Architecture. That is all we want to do. So whatever task or robot the robot has, is a repetitive task. It cannot do much of a logical task. For let's say, for example, you cannot ask the robot to go and stitch a person's hand. The nurse can do that. The nurse is skilled to do that. If you make the nurse move around with a cart of, let's say, clothes, it is not efficient for the nurse to be doing that recursively. If it is a very big hospital, the hospital has to, let's say, employ many more nurses than are required. So what we are trying to do is make their job more efficient and more easier for them. We are not trying to replace anybody. Humans cannot be replaced, at least for a long time. Being in the robotics industry, we know that there are a lot of things robots cannot do. And we have to take into factor that the technology has not yet reached a point where it can readily replace a human being. It is in the near future a possible thing. But I think by the time rules and regulations would have come up where the government would, I think that would be a logical answer to that.
Sure. So Pratheesh, that was really great, and a startup in India and a humanoid robot being designed and all being done in Fusion 360.
Yes.
So that's nice to hear. But you know, Pratheesh did not want to share a lot of images because you know he felt that there are a lot of startups out here, people who want to understand what Pratheesh is doing. So you did not see a lot of inside stuff of what went into the
robot. We would like you to come down and see the practical thing. We have it running here. So we expect you to come down to Siddhartha 1 and you can see us, you can question us, you can push it around.
So Pratheesh mentioned two Autodesk software here. One is Fusion 360 and the other is Autodesk Eagle. Autodesk Eagle is a PCB design software that we have and it integrates very well with Fusion for the mechanical design. So these are the two software that they have used. And with this, I thank you, Pratheesh.
Thank you.
For
thank
such
you
a lovely much. Presentation.
Thank you, everyone.
And please be on stage.
Yeah.
And I would like to call on my colleague, Sri, to present you with a small token of appreciation.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.